Ond noswaith dda, bawb. Good evening, everybody. A croeso cynnes iawn i chi gyd i ddarlith rithiol arall gan y Comisiwn. Heno, bydd John Dollery a Scott Lloyd yn trafod mapio dwfn a chifau ystadau fel rhan o wythnos achwiliwch eich achifau. A very warm welcome to you all to another Royal Commission online lecture. Tonight, John Dollery and Scott Lloyd will be talking about deep mapping estate archives as part of Explore Your Archives Week. This evening's talk will be recorded and shared on other platforms. For those not watching this live, you're also welcome to send us any questions or share your comments, and John and Scott will reply to them as soon as possible. Erbi the sgwrs hon drwy y gyfrwng y Saesneg heno, cofiwch fod croeso i chi gysylltu â ni yn y Gymraeg os ydych chi'n am ofyn cwestiwn neu adael sylw. Hoffwn naw cyflwyno ein siaradwyr heno, sef John Dollery a Scott Lloyd. Swyddog mapio Comisiwn Brenhinol yw John, a wedi bod yn ei swydd ers 2015. Ar hyn o bryd mae'n gweithio ar sawl prosiect gan gynnwys mapio dwfn a chifau ystadau, ac ar y gweithio prosiect newydd, sef Merdd Canoloesol Cymru, mapio deiaduriaeth lenyddol mewn ranbarth ffiniau Brydeinig. Mae gan John B.A. mewn archeoleg ac M.A. mewn archeoleg tirwedd o Brifysgol Cymru y Jyndod Dewi Sant. Mae hefyd yn gymrawd o gymdeithas deiaddorol frenhinol ag un aelod o'r cymdeithas cartograffig Brydeinig, cymdeithas Charles Close a'r grŵp arolwg tirwedd. John Dollery is the mapping officer at the Royal Commission on the Ancient Historical Monuments of Wales and has been in post since 2015. John is working on several projects, including the Deep Mapping Estate Archives, and also on the upcoming UKRI project, the Medieval March of Wales, mapping literary geography in a British border region. John has a BA in archaeology and MA in landscape archaeology from the University of Wales at Trinity St David's. He is also a fellow of the Royal Geographical Society, as well as a member of the British Cartographic Society, Charles Close Society, and the Landscape Survey Group. Mae Scott wedi gweithio yn y Comisiwn ers 2008 a wedi cyflawni nifer o rolau amrywiol. Swyddog datblygu prosiectau yw e ar hyn o bryd yn gwneud ceisiadau am gyllid allanol ar gyfer prosiectau amrywiol. Mae wedi gweithio ar y restr o feysydd brwydro hanesyddol yn Cymru. Mae gan fod ddiddordeb yn Gymru oesodd canol, ac yn ysgrifennodd The Arthurian Places and Names of Wales, a gyhoeddwyd gan Wasg Prifysol Cymru yn 2017. Ar hyn o bryd, mae'n gweithio ar brosiect mapio dwfn a chifau ystadau Cymru, y bydd yn siarad amdano heno. Scott has worked at the Commission since 2008 in a variety of roles. He is currently a project development officer, making applications for external projects funding for various projects. He has worked on the list of historic battlefields in Wales, has an interest in medieval Wales, and wrote the Arthurian Place Names of Wales, which was published by the University of Press in 2017. He is currently working on the Welsh Estate Archives Deep Mapping Project, which he'll be speaking about tonight. Felly, a hynny eiria, drosodd I John a Scott.
Okay. Right. Thank you, everybody. Welcome, everybody.
You're still on mute, Scott. Sorry.
Am I on mute now?
You've come off mute, but we can't hear you. Still can't hear you. Oh, I think everybody else can. Okay. My fault.
Okay. Can everyone hear me now? Is that okay?
Yeah, we can hear you, Scott. Go on. Carry on.
Cool. Okay. Great. Okay, so this project was a two-year project funded by the Arts and Humanities Research Council, and as you can see here with our grand array of logos, as we have to do for every single project we have something to do with. So we have the Institute for the Study of Welsh Estates at Bangor University, who lead on the project. There's ourselves, there's our colleagues at the National Library of Wales, colleagues from the Department of Information Studies at Aberystwyth University, and also North East Wales Archives, who have also provided many of the maps and images that we'll be using this evening. Okay. So the idea of the project was a pilot project to study what is the best way of making use of this wealth of material that we hold. As many of you will know, we are blessed in this country with a mountain of archive material. However, there's so much of it, sometimes it's difficult to know what's the best way to explore it and the best way to discover it. So as part of this project, we chose a small area of North East Wales. So we've got the parishes of Llandegla, Llanarmon Eal and Llanferis in Denbighshire. And then in Flintshire, we have Trithin, Nurquis, and then the parish of Mold, but only west of the River Allin. We had to draw a line somewhere, and that was big enough. At 125 square kilometres, we thought that was quite enough for us to be getting on with. So, Ordnance Survey Master Map. Ordnance Survey Master Map is the basis for all modern mapping that we use, Ordnance Survey mapping we use in the UK. It is the single most detailed layer, and as you can see here, you've got every single building is marked, and that is a polygon that is clickable, is an individual element of the map. It's not just drawn, it is a digital polygon. And this is the basis for everything and what we decided we were going to use as the basis for the historic mapping. So we bring through the historic, the survey accuracy of modern mapping into historic mapping. So the earliest consistent and comprehensive survey of Wales was the Ordnance Survey County Series 25 inch to the mile mapping. That's 1 to 2,500. And to just give you an idea of the scale, that's 10 times larger than the orange Ordnance Survey maps you'll use if you're out walking in the mountains. Flintshire and Denbighshire were the priority areas because of the mineral rights and the coal. I think Gladstone may have had something to do with it as well. So they were bumped up the list. So the survey was moving up from the south of Britain, but Flintshire and Denbighshire were bumped up the list because of their importance. The earliest first edition mapping contains details and information that you don't find on even the reprints or the second edition. So the first edition is of prime importance. One of the main features on the first edition is the depiction of boundaries, particularly parish and more importantly, township boundaries. So on the first edition, they're present. On the second edition, they are removed because the Local Government Act in 1888 decided that the local townships were no longer to be used for administrative purposes. Therefore, the Ordnance Survey didn't put them on. So you have to access the first edition sheets to see those township boundaries. And also, up until about 1880, Ordnance Survey produced books of reference, which gave the acreage and perhaps more importantly, the land use of each parcel depicted on the map. However, these were discontinued in 1880, so they only exist for a small region of Wales, Flintshire, Denbighshire, I think one or two in Pembrokeshire and a handful in Glamorganshire. You can see here how the 25-inch coverage progressed over time. You'll notice in 1862, we've got about six sheets around Pembroke Dock. By 1875, a bit more of Pembrokeshire was complete, a few in the valleys, but you'll notice that Flintshire and Denbighshire are quite well covered by 1875. And this is the period that our mapping comes from that we've used in the project. By 1885, most of the South Wales and the valleys have been done, and it's not until 1890 that the 25-inch survey for Wales is completed. You'll notice some of the gaps in the survey. This is the areas that were not covered at the 25-inch scale. For these areas, you have to go to the 6-inch scale, which is 1 to 10,560. So you can see there's a massive undertaking to get this work done, but it did take a long time. Now, it's known as the County Series, and the Ordnance Survey originally kept quite rigidly to this. But as you can see, sometimes it was taken to the point of absurdity. Here we have our little bit of Breconshire, and this is a county 6-inch sheet for Breconshire. The rest of the map is Glamorganshire, but as that's a different country, they didn't print it on the map sheet. Now, this is a bit absurd, and Ordnance Survey very quickly realised that this was a silly way of doing things, so it was changed. And they then printed everything always up to the map line. Here's an example again for our project area. Here's Catol, or Cadol as we know it today, on the main road between Mold and Rhythin. Loggerheads is just down here on the blank bit. So this is the Flintshire side. The blank bit is Denbighshire. this causes us a slight problem when we're trying to do our georeferencing, because then we have to try and splice two maps together that are on different, they're all, should be really be on the same sheet. So here we have the sheet with Denbighshire added to it, and this is the type of sheet we like to use. This is a particularly fine example of the 25-inch mapping. You'll notice the detail. You'll notice that the buildings are depicted in red. We have water in blue, and then we have the roads in a light orangey colour. Now, many of the sheets we came across were only black and white. Colour sheets are much scarcer than the black and white sheets. And indeed, one of the main problems in the project was trying to find the 25-inch sheets for the project area, which was surprisingly difficult. And we had to go through five institutions to get the sheets we needed. And we only needed 52 sheets. So it was quite a problem. You'll also notice here we have these individual field numbers. This is what Ordnance Survey set out to do, was to give every field a number, give it an acreage, and then give it a land use initially. Again, the land use option was dropped as time went by. So how did it work? Well, what you were supposed to do is have the map, but then you're also supposed to look it up in the book of reference. Now, these book of references, again, as I said, stopped about 1880. This is from 1872. They were broken down into townships for Flintshire. You'll notice here the field number. You'll have an acreage to three decimal places, and then you get land use. So we have rough pasture, refuse, arable, houses, yards, woods, roads, railways, and so on. It's not an extensive list of terminology, but it is very useful, and we can use it alongside earlier mapping and later mapping to see how land use has changed over time. One of the main reasons they did it was to gather information about the size of each administrative unit, and this is then used to make decisions about parliamentary boundaries and for census records and so on. So it was quite an important job. The Ordnance Survey went to an awful lot of trouble to get this information, as we'll see. The first edition for Flintshire was published in the early 1870s. By the 1890s, they decided to just reprint it. So this wasn't a new edition, it was just a reprint. But you'll notice they've changed a few things in the reprint. Now we have the field number, but we also have the acreage printed underneath. So you no longer need to refer to a book of reference to get the acreage. But this is perhaps more interesting. You'll notice this phrase running across the map here. Obsolete boundary retained to separate different sets of parcel numbers. Because as you will remember before, the townships, this is the boundary between two townships, so therefore there's two sets of running numbers, one for each township. So this one field was divided into two by a township boundary. But the township boundary is no longer required administratively, but it had to be retained until they did the second edition of the map, and then that boundary is removed. Hence the importance of the first edition. You'll also notice on the first edition, sometimes we get these individual trees. They were surveyed in. Ordnance Survey went again to an immense amount of effort and surveyed in individual trees. We have not polygonized every single tree. We'll leave that for somebody else. One of the pressing issues the Ordnance Survey came across was the requirement for a detailed set of parish and township boundaries. This has long been flagged as a requirement. The church was unsure of where some of the boundaries were. Local councils and authorities were unsure exactly where boundaries were, and particularly in upland areas. Therefore, the Ordnance Survey undertook a massive boundary survey a year or two before the main survey took place. So what you can see here is an Ordnance Survey boundary remark book. You'll notice it, the title, Perambulation of the Boundaries Between, and then it gives either parishes or townships and tells you which townships and parishes the notes are referring to. The opening page is always a sketch map. So here we can see the parish of Trithin, and then around you can see the different parishes and townships that border on the parish. And the dotted line is the content of this survey book. So as you can see, for Trithin, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you need 7 books almost to get the whole thing. It can be quite complicated. There are some 30,000 of these notebooks at the National Archive at Kew in London. So there's a mountain of material to be looked at.
but an awful lot was recorded that sometimes we're not familiar with the manuscript and the historiography of how our Ordnance Survey maps were put together. Here's an example. Here we see the boundary between Flintshire and Denbighshire. You'll notice the boundary here with red crosses through it. That is the boundary as depicted upon the tithe map, which was often used as the basis for the for this discussion. And what happened was we had two mearsmen. A mearsman is a boundary man, and he was responsible for his parish or township. So here we can see the boundary of Llanarmon from page 16 to 21, pointed out by Edward Jones. So he would walk along the parish of Llanarmon, somebody on the other side would be representing Trithin, and they would agree on where the boundary was. So there's the one in red they disagreed on, and here's the one they drew in between. So you've got these little symbols, FW, face of wall, 4 foot BBK, 4 foot from base of bank, and here, center of furrow. And here's a little cross section of that furrow on which the boundary is based. So you can see the level of detail here is quite extensive. Interestingly, for Denbighshire, the survey for Denbighshire was begun in 1871 when this was done, and they were busy looking at the boundaries of townships. Now, the township of Byddygri in Llanarmon, which is now sort of absorbed into the parish of Llandegla, was actually surveyed in this way. And you can see here the survey quite clearly, but you'll notice the red crosses put through the survey and the names of the townships stricken out. This is because when they did the full survey and the publication, Ordnance Surveyor changed its rules and no longer printed the township boundaries. Therefore, Denbighshire was surveyed but was not printed. So the only way we can find some of these boundaries is to go back into the archive. And this boundary here is the one that divides the township of Byddygri into two. You've got Byddygri Abbot and Byddygri Eyal. So this is a very important document, enables us to reconstruct the township boundaries. Ordnance Survey town plans. There were some 28 done for Wales, any town with a population of over 4,000. They were surveyed at the same time as the 25-inch, and they show interior details of public buildings. They were the largest scale mapping undertaken by Ordnance Survey, and all the ones for Wales can be viewed on the National Library of Wales website. Here we see an example. Here we are, the church in the middle of Mould, and you can see the interior detail here, and also gives you how many seats it'll hold. In this instance, 1,111 seems strangely specific. Then we create the polygons using the master map, as we mentioned at the beginning. The master map is then cut and merged to match the historical map, and this retains the modern accuracy of master map in our product. And then you put the two together, and now you can see each building can be clicked on as a polygon, and notice the little pop-up opens up with information about that particular polygon. And we have this for every single polygon on the map. John will go through this with you in more detail shortly. I also want to briefly mention the Poor Law map of Mould from 1862. Not a great deal of Poor Law mapping survives for Wales, but Mould is probably the best example. And here you can see the level of detail. Here's the church again, but look at the numbers for every single building around here. And every one of these numbers relates back to apportionment, which gives you details for the poor law and how they worked out, how much to charge, etc. It's in a phenomenal amount of detail, and it's from 1862. It's a good decade before the survey. The poor law is also responsible for a higher accuracy of mapping than Ordnance Survey when it comes to buildings. So the Ordnance Survey on the right is, you know, often considered to be the best standard we have, but on the left you will clearly see that the outbuildings in grey are much better defined than they are on the Ordnance Survey. And also the details about the boundaries in the gardens and the other buildings is much more specific and accurate than on the Ordnance Survey. Ordnance Survey has number 216 for this whole parcel, whereas on the poor law, we've got numbers 401, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we're getting a granular detail from the poor law mapping. Sadly, we just have very little of it for Wales. Tithe mapping. Tithe Commutation Act 1836 was trying to bring together a standardised way of charging the tithe, because there had been differences across England and Wales, and it was getting a little unwieldy. The differences in the styles of the map, they were not always based on fresh surveys. Often they're concocted from existing mapping. So we have to be careful not to rely upon the accuracy, the survey accuracy of the tithe mapping. However, it's the apportionments that contain the real detail we're looking for. Field names, land use, owners and tenants. And despite the fact that everyone was given printed forms, there's still a variance in the information that was provided. All of the tithe mapping and the apportionments are available on the National Library of Wales Places of Wales website. So if you're outside of our project area, you can access the material there. Here's a nice example of a tithe map. This is one for Trithin. You can clearly see the parcels, number in each, the roads in yellow and the blue for the rivers. That is a very nice example. We're very fortunate. And a little closer just to show you how nice it really is. This is available on the website. So if you want to see the tithe map for Trithin, there you go. That is a nice example. We're always delighted to have one of those. Then, sadly, we get other examples which are not so good. This is the tithe map for the township of Budidras. You will notice here that there's not many fields on it. The reason for this is they didn't record every single field. All they recorded was the farm holding, if you like. So the whole area that the farm owned is given one number, and that is referred to in the apportionment. So for Bodidras, we have about 12 entries. And just to show that there were fields there, you'll notice here, here's the Hall of Bodidras. If you just look around Bodidras, you'll see on this map it's blank. But if we go to an estate map of about the same period, you can clearly see there's the hall and there's all manner of fields showing there. We have georeferenced this onto the project website, but unfortunately we don't have the apportionment that goes with it, so we don't know what the numbers relate to, what they're relating to. I assume they give us a field name, an area and perhaps a land use, but sadly at some point the apportionment's been lost. Once we have the ordnance survey polygons we derive from MasterMap for the historic OS, it's then possible to use those as the basis for linking the tithe mapping to. So here we have the tithe map of Llandegla, and you can see it's been georeferenced because tithe mapping very rarely points to the north, so it's always at an angle. And you'll see we've managed to create a polygon for every single field. Every one of these fields links across to to the information from the apportionment. And you'll see we have the name of the field, Hidir Mawr. It's part of Bodidras. It's an agricultural field. It's arable. Shows as a parcel on the map. It's owned by Edward Mostyn Lloyd Mostyn. And what we did with the tithe, following a question from one of our advisory board members, they were doing research upon female land ownership. And it was said, is there anything we can do with this project that might help that type of research? And it's actually quite a simple addition, is to add a couple of columns to our data. So we added landowner gender. So we've got male or female. And then if you want to do a search for land ownership, you can bring up all the female-owned land, the male-owned land. It just adds another layer of research for a very simple addition to the data table. And also we have acres, roots, perches, and then we have a little formula which transfers this into a 3-decimal place number. And then we can compare that to Ordnance Survey, and we can compare it to the modern modern area as done by Ordnance Survey. Enclosure maps and awards. For our project area, between 1800 and 1830, there was enclosure awards. These were designed to take the open land, the open mountain land, and it was divided up into allotments. For this purpose, there was a very long, wordy award, which we'll look at in a minute, but there was also some excellent maps. And in our experience, they were very well surveyed and had a great level of detail. And they show clearly what they were going to do. They were going to parcel up the land. So the lines, land, the allotments they were going to create are depicted as a dotted line, which means they weren't there beforehand. And this enables us now to remove those dotted lines from the map and give us a landscape that shows us what it was like before apportionment. And it also allows us to understand some of the extent of named commons pre-1800. There's often references to the common of X, but we might know roughly where it is, but we're never quite sure of its extent. These enclosure maps really help us understand that. Here's an example of one page of the award for one parish. So, for example, for the parish of Llanarmon, we've got some 40 pages of this. It's very wordy, very repetitive, and often the main person who owns the, who's been given the allotment can be mentioned at the top of the page, and the actual numbered allotment that goes to them can be mentioned halfway down the page. You do have to read through it. But in order to do this and get it into the system, we have to tabulate it. So, slide I wasn't expecting. So just to give you a rough idea of the information in it, John Thomas was given one allotment, number 267, situate on Nerquis Mountain. And we always have this situate on, and then it tells you where it is. So what we can do then, we can backwards engineer the numbered allotments and work out the extent of any given common, which is really quite useful for dealing with earlier documents. And you'll see here as well, they too give acreages, 1 acre, 2 roods and 12 perches, which we can then use to compare and make sure we've got the right polygon and make sure we've got the right field. So we turn that wordy award into a table. I can't stress this enough. If you're dealing with this type of data, please, please put it in tables. And once it's in a table, we can do something with it. If we just transcribe it, it's much more limited in what we can do. And you'll see here how the commons which these allotments were situated on are all named. You'll see here Mould Mountain, Gwernamynydd, Arthyn Went. And what you can do across, once you've got the whole document in front of you, you can then just display on the map all of those parcels that come from each of those commons. You'll also notice we have the person who it's allotted to. Again, we have the male-female column, acres, roods and perches, and then our three decimal point number for comparison with OS and modern survey. So that was my lockdown job, was tabulating enclosure awards. Here's an example of one. This is near Llandegla. You'll notice here we have the dot and straight line here. This is the sort of the ones. This is what we are going to do. We are going to make an allotment here. You'll also notice the little red T marks. They determine who had responsibility for this boundary. So the owner of 16 was responsible for this wall, but the owner of 17 was responsible for that one. And this is often something that carries through into modern day boundaries as well. I shan't get embroiled in all that. And then all of the information from the award is linked to the polygon in the table here. So we've got, awarded to the Bishop of St Asaph, acres, roods and perches, historic acreage, modern acreage. You can see we're within 0.3 of an acre. We're content that we're talking about the same field. And then there's the rest of the data in the table below. If you click on this little arrow mark here, it brings up the tables. And then you can search, as John will show you shortly. Not all enclosure maps look nice. This is a rather hideous example. This is the village of Gwynafield, looking a little bit ropey here. You can just about see some of the lines, but because we have an award which gives us a description of each parcel and says it is to the north of, it is bounded by parcel X, we can start to recreate these. So we've managed to recreate parcels, and then you can see the information here is drawn from it. So this is what enables us to do by having the written award and the map and a bit of jiggery-pokery, technically using some filters on the image and using contemporary mapping, sort of from Ordnance Survey a little bit later. It enables us to recreate these polygons so that map that otherwise is a bit useless comes to life. All of the enclosed areas, Enclosure Act areas from about 1800 to 1830 are shown here in orange. The bits in orange were not enclosed. There was no fields on them. There was very little on them at all as late as 1830. You'll notice there's a few little purple bits in the orange. These are known as encroachments, and some of those do go back a little bit further. But you can see nearly half of our project area was unenclosed. This is a map that's the Baddesley map from 1740. This is owned by the Grosvenor Estate, the Duke of Westminster, and they very kindly gave us permission to scan it, partly because the map is so huge, it's annoying to use. It's 3 meters square, so it's virtually unusable. So what we've managed to do here is get it digitized and make it available. And this shows all the upland areas that the Westminster Estate had mineral rights for. So when we create the enclosure, you can see the difference. 1800, you'll notice a lot more purple than we had in 1740. 1740, some of the areas here, which were considered to be encroachments, have now been made enclosed land and are considered normal open, normal enclosed land. So you see how the orange area has retreated slightly as time has gone on. So what this map from 1740 does, it enables us to push that line that between cultivated land and open land a little further down the hill. And we have this total control over how we look at these things. Estate mapping. Here's an estate map. This is the, I don't remember which estate it is now off the top of my head, but Hadland Estate, I think. So here's a nice map for Flanarmon Parish. It shows us the River Allin. And interestingly for this map, it also shows us a little bit of where the new Turnpike Road had been put in. We found the Turnpike Road maps to be most useful. They show us the field system before the Turnpike Road was put in, and quite often they refer to township boundaries, which are otherwise difficult to find any information about. Again, as with most cadastral maps, you have a map as a key with a numerical or letter code, and that refers to an apportionment, which gives you the name of the field, the acreages, and you can start to work things out from there. You'll notice on this map, we have this bit down here. Looks a little bit like the Millennium Falcon. This is not geographically in the correct place according to the rest of the map. So when we georeference these onto the modern, onto our system, we have to separate it out as a separate map. This you can see here. So here's a Millennium Falcon shape down here, and here's the Clonarmon fields over here. And we've also managed to give them a little bit of a colour scheme depending upon their attribution. So the forest comes out in a brighter green. You'll notice we get a display name, which is the field name. So here it's Everpistis. It's the Bathavon Estate. A tenement called Minhadlin. It's an arable field owned by Reverend Fellwell, and then the same information as we have for all the others. Now, what you can do is you can layer these on top of each other and compare and contrast. This is a map of the Nerquist Estate from 1734. Lovely map. Again, lots of little sections which needed to be cut up and removed to be put in the correct geographical place. Didn't matter for them, but for us trying to put it onto a modern map, we need to take it apart and break it down into its constituent parts. Here we have a nice elevation of Plasnewydd, or Nerquist Hall, as we'd call it today. And you'll notice here as well, a very nice collection of survey tools. So you've got set square, compass, and in the description over here, it also mentions the Gunter chain. A Gunter chain was 22 yards long, divided into 100 equal sized pieces. And this is what was used to survey fields. So effectively it was pegged, dragged out to its full length, pegged again, and so on and so forth around the landscape. And considering that's the way they did it, we've always been very impressed with the accuracy. Here we see those bits dissected and put in their correct geographical position. And again, the same information that we have. So every single layer contains this information from the apportionment, and you can view all of that information in a map interface. The estates, all the different estates in one area. Now, if you, wherever you may live, you might think, what estate am I on? What estate is that field down the road on? It's all often very difficult to work it out. What we've managed to do with the project now is create a map of all the different estates and what they held at any given time. So you can sort of work out where you should be looking. So this is an example of Llandegla. You'll see here the orange is the Cragat estate. The green is Mostyn. The blue here is the Bishop of St Asaph. And the greyish one here is Watkin Williams Wynd, their estate. So you get an indication, and all the little estates that have smaller landownings, two or three fields, but it all shows up quite neatly. And again, it's all clickable as well. This is the Baddeslade map in close-up, nearing the end now. I just want to show this as a way that these maps can take us back even further. You'll notice here, Cefn D in Byddygri Abbot Township in Llanarmon Parish is part of the Manor of Vallecrucis. Now, at the dissolution of the monasteries in 1530s, there's a wealth of documentation. The new owners of the lands from the monasteries often did a survey, and we're very fortunate to have a survey of some of the Valley Crucis lands. And Cefndir is also named in the works of John Lulland as well, as in relation to Valley Crucis. But here now we actually have a few boundaries to this piece of land. And it tells us it's in Byddygri Abbot Township. Again, the importance of these township boundaries. You will remember near the beginning, I was showing you the Ordnance Survey Ordnance Surveyor's notebook with that boundary that separated the two parts of Byddygri Township. So now what we can do, if we follow that boundary provided for us by Ordnance Survey, we can indeed see that it separates Byddygri Eyal and Byddygri Eyal Abbot, and the Baddesleid map from 1740 is in agreement as well. We can now get back accurately into the medieval period. We're going from the known and we step back each stage of the way. As we step back, the mapping becomes more fragmented, but there's still an awful lot of it and it can be built up to create an overarching picture. So at this stage now, I'm going to hand over to John, and John's going to show you the system in action. And then at the end of the talk, we'll send you through the links to use as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Scott. So I'm just going to share my screen, if you bear with me a minute. This will stop sharing the screen. There we go. So now, hopefully, you should be able... Can everyone see that? Just to double check, am I sharing the right screen?
Yeah, you are. Yeah,
fine. There we go. I just want to double check. So what I'm going to do is... thank you very much, Scott, for covering that about the project and the types of mapping. What I'm going to do primarily is look a bit more about the methodology, how we've been able to draw all this stuff together. But more importantly, I want to show you how you can get access to all this information for free. So first of all, I put in the link before link to the project website. So please feel free to click on that. And if you've got two screens, if you're very techie like me, feel free to follow along as we delve into the deep mapping interface. So first of all, we've obviously got the project website, which gives more information about each type of map source we've used, a bit about the methodology, and obviously here as well, you'll see you've got the main project web map, and we've also created a series of other different web maps. The reason we've done that is the pre-project web map has everything in it, so the first edition, the tie, the enclosure, and it can be, you know, there's quite a lot of information in there. So what we've also done is broken down those individual constituent parts as well. So we've got a web map which just focuses on the first edition Ordnance Survey mapping. We've got one web map which focuses on the town plan, the tithe map, the enclosure map. And we haven't made it just yet, but recently we will be making available one that just looks at estate mapping. So the main project website is the way to get access to all this information. Like I said, I put the link in the description, but the other way of getting to it is just simply Google searching Deep Map of Estate Archives, and that should bring up as a top result this web map or website. So what we're going to do now is going to have a look at the main project web map. So we'll click on View Map, and this will open up the project website, web map. So one thing I would like to stress is that this is all bilingual, so it's available in English and Welsh, both the website as well as the web map. So if you wanted to view Welsh, you click there, and that will open the same interface, and it'll be in Welsh, and all the titles are in Welsh as well. Anyway, so here's the project web map, and effectively, the way it works is like any normal GIS. You've got these things at the top, which are your content layers. So you've got one which is OS, which basically has all the information to do with the Ordnance Survey. The next one is TI, which is tithe, EN, enclosure, ES is estate. You've also got one there which hasn't got anything at the moment, which is DO for documents. I'll talk a little about that in a minute. And then the last one we got is BD, which is to do with boundary information. So first of all, we've got the Ordnance Survey. And the core ethos of this project is that every time you look at a web map, you've got the original raster images as well as the polygons. And this is the same for the tithe and the estate. So as you zoom in, you should be able to see the original raster mapping that we've got the information from. So with the OS, like Scott was saying, the main process was the first thing was not only, you know, sourcing them, it was then georeferencing them. So what we did is we scanned each individual sheet and cropped them. And then what we do is to georeference them is we put a point on almost every single field intersection or corner of building, usually per sheet. So for this one that we're looking at now, probably around about 400 to 600 control points per sheet. Now, that sounds like a lot of time, but actually, when you start getting into the process, it becomes quite quick. And in fact, for the whole project area, we've got 52 OS sheets, and that took roughly about 2.5 weeks to georeference all of them. And as we were georeferencing, well, what we'd do is we'd add a point to that corner of the intersection there, and then we'd use master map, or the vertices of master map, to then snap that control point, if it still existed, on the modern map. So you can see there, you've got the same field boundary. So the idea is, the more control points you could have, you can then sort of make a better overlay between the modern map and the historic. So we've got a little tool here, hopefully, which will prove the point. So we've got a little splitter there. And you'll see, if I stretch and zoom over, you can see that pretty much the georeferencing of the historic map is almost bang on with the modern map underneath. Now, this is important because when we go to vectorize, we want to try and get as much accuracy there as possible. So with the georeferencing as well, once that had been undertaken, we use this process called spline. So you've got a variety of control points. And what that does, this spline transformation, is it roughly rubber sheets the map and makes it fit a little bit better to the modern map underneath. And then once you've got that best fit, what we then did is took an extract of master map. So we basically took an extract for that entire sheet length there. And then what we do is a manual process of cutting and merging the polygons to reflect the map underneath. So if I show you on a black and white sheet the power of polygons, if we turn on this here, Parcels First Edition OS, you'll see that the entire map springs into color. Now, again, like Scott was saying before, any one of these maps or polygons we can click on, and we've got information there. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to zoom in a little bit just to give us a bit more detail. So here you can see the type of information they're recording per feature. Now, that can be agricultural field, it could be a building, it could be a river, it could be a mill pond. Whatever information is either in the map or an associated book of reference, that then goes into the record. So this is the power of digital vector data and GIS. So you can see here, you've got the parcel number, you've got the name, if it was named, you've got the feature type, is it a building, is it an agricultural field? Because this is an early OS map, so this one was surveyed in 1871, we have a book of reference, which for this period gives us land use. So you can see that in 1871, this specific field was a pasture. And then also we've got this OS acreage, and you can see how accurate the modern data and the historic data is. It's almost, you know, within 0.01 of an acre there. So 2.8, 2.8, pretty much the same. So that gives us the confidence of accuracy when we're vectorizing these maps. So if we click, you know, if we had the historic acreage was 4 acres and we're getting 2, then we know there's something going wrong. You know, it needs to be a bigger feature. So this enables us to have confidence in that accuracy. The other way this would happen as well is that we had double accuracy. So I would do all the vectorization, and then Scott would then do a lot of the what we call attribution. So he was also checking the work I did, and vice versa. So again, it was a way of quickly and efficiently getting as much information of those polygons as possible. And just to give you a sense of the scale of all these polygons, so this polygonal layer for this, you know, 125 square kilometers consists of around 35,000 polygons. But we managed to do that within the space of a year, effectively. So the amount of work, it sounds like a lot, but once you get into this process between two, and there's only two of us really doing it, it really does prove you can do this very rapidly and very quickly. And the main reason for that is you're already using an existing polygonal data set rather than creating the data from scratch. So again, you've got a wealth of information there, and you can add whatever information you want. So, you know, we call this process total digitization. So the idea is that we try and record as much information that's either in the map or book of reference. So the idea with this whole process is that theoretically we're not missing anything. When we've had projects in the past that have done similar things, they're usually on a small scale and focused on specific feature types or landscape elements or topography. Whereas this captures everything. So without fear or favor, we're recording the information as it is in situ on that specific map source. Again, we've also got information there about the original source organization. So what this method actually proves as well is that we can take a range of material from different collections, whether that's our own, the Royal Commission, or the National Library, or the National Museum, and we can bring this all together, and it's almost a portal or a mechanism by which you can ingest it all in, but then have links out to where you've got the information from. So I'll show you with the Tithe in a minute, you can embed hyperlinks with the Tithe, which then links back to the National Library's website, so you can see the original images. So again, it's not taking ownership or anything from anyone. If more than anything, it's acting as a portal, which then spreads out to different archive institutions, repositories. So yes, that's the type of information you've got there. So again, this is just the first edition OS, and you can see you've got quite a lot. The other thing I'll say as well is we did also vectorize the data outside of the project area. So this is the stuff in gray. But what we didn't do is attribute that information. And actually what we probably do in reflection in future is take it up to that boundary and not have these artificial boundaries there, because that is problematic. But the benefit of doing the entire sheet means that if we were ever to upscale this to do the rest of Flintshire or the rest of Denbighshire, those map sheets should be able to fit in with the vector data that we've already created. So you should be able to seamlessly carry on. Well, while we're on the OS as well, there's a few other, it's not just polygons we created. So, you know, we were also interested in the topography, but we've also got streams and drainage. So if I turn that layer on, hopefully you'll see all the streams come up. So any features that, you know, not only polygons, we've also got streams there. You've also got earthworks and outcrops. So this is probably more, if we go up towards mold, you'll see, actually we'll go down towards Trident because you've got quite a lot of mining down there. So we've got separate polygons for these earthquake features. There we go. You can see you've got quite a lot of topography there. And this is because we wanted to capture that fantastic topographical hashing that the Ordnance Survey has to give that sense of topography as well. We've also got trackways as a separate layer. Now, the reason we did this is we wanted to make sure that the acreages we were getting with the polygons were exact. If we had the trackways cut in, that would significantly reduce the acreage size. So we wanted to make sure they were, you know, exact. So again, with these trackways, you can click on that and you've got information about that specific trackway, what field number it runs through, what map it was recorded on, the date it was recorded. So again, a wealth of information there. And obviously these trackways are still pretty much the core of public rights of way today. The last thing we recorded, and probably the most, one of the most important, are the boundaries. Now, like Scott was saying, it's very challenging, actually, to work out, especially township boundaries, because as we speak today, there is no one overall data set or polygonal data set for township boundaries in England, Wales. We do have parish boundaries that was done by Kane and Oliver back nearly 20 years ago now, which was very good, but unfortunately doesn't have the accuracy that we'd expect today. And the reason for that is they were mapping these boundaries off 1 inch to the mile sheets, whereas we're mapping off the 25 inch. So we've got a wealth of detail. And why this is important is that all these data sets, so for instance, the parish boundary data set is being built on by existing heritage organisations. And because that accuracy isn't there, it really does cause problems. So when you're zoomed out a level of, you know, this level, it doesn't really make that much difference. But when you zoom right in and you've got a, you know, a data set that was built on 1 inch to the mile, it becomes very, very problematic. And what this data set is that it should give you every single break in the boundary. So for this one, you've got from there, you can see that it's the township boundary of Ardenwent. It's undefined. That's how it was defined. You can see undefined there. And then you've got where it runs to. Again, with this section here, you've got centre of road. Unfortunately, you can't move the box, but if you zoom out a little bit, hopefully you'll be able to see the to and from and that type of thing. But again, it just shows the wealth of information we've got there. And, you know, we've not just done that for the township. We've also done it for the parishes. As if I turn the map off and zoom out, so you can see this is all Mold Parish, Llanferis, Llanarmon, Llandegla, and also the bits outside, so places like Minera, that type of thing. We've also got the 100 boundaries. Again, this is picked up in the OS, but, you know, doesn't tend to go back a bit earlier. So you've got Maelor, Mold, Llanarmon, Bromfield. And yes, the last one, obviously, is the county boundary. And you'll notice that the county boundary in 1871 was significantly different than it is today, because this bit of Llanarmon is now all in Denbighshire, whereas historically it was in Flintshire. So that's the OS. The next maps in the system we've got is the Tithe. So like Scott was saying before, we can turn at the bottom, you might need to move in. Anything that's an image, you'll see Tithe map image. So if we turn on the one for Nerquist, which is also quite a nice example, and zoom in, and then we turn the parcels on, parcels for Nerquist. Again, you'll see it's all been polygonized. I can click on any information there, any parcel, and we've got exactly all the information that was recorded. Fortunately for this data set, a lot was recorded by the Canevin project, by the National Library of Wales. So we were able to seamlessly take that tabulated information and put it into a GIS system. So in here, you've got things like the apportionment name. So you've got the name that is given on the apportionment. We've also got display name. The reason we put that in is because sometimes the apportionment name would be ditto. So when people were transcribing, rather than putting the original field name, they'd just put ditto. So we wanted to have this here that to say, well, what is it dittoing? So you've got that idea there. Again, you've got agricultural field, what it is, land use, if it's recorded. So some tag maps recorded land use, some didn't. But then the other thing then is you've got this thing of the landowner gender. And again, the same thing with the acreages. So you can see the historic acreage is 4.4. We've got the modern at 4.1. But what we're going for here is geographic fidelity. So you'll know that the tithe maps, because they're an amalgamation of different estate maps, so none of the tithe maps in the project area were ever surveyed on the ground. They were made of composite enclosure or estate maps that have been sort of wedded together. You'll see that it doesn't geographically, in terms of georeferencing, fit as spatially as it does with the tithe. With the first edition OS, but you can see it's the same, near enough the same acreages. It's pretty much following the same geometric shape. It's probably the same field and hasn't changed since then. The other thing I'll say with the tithe is when we georeference them, the key to all of this was that 25-inch OS vector layer. Once we vectorize the 25-inch OS, we could then use the vectors that we created for that to then snap and georeference the tithe to. And the reason that's important is that these are closer in date. So this tithe map was surveyed in 1838. The OS was done in 1871. And you can see that, you know, there's a period of 50 years. Whereas we were trying to georeference this tithe map from 1838 straight to modern OS master map, it'd be a lot more difficult because a lot more theoretically has changed. So like Scott was saying, the idea is that we can take these vector data sets that are, you know, closer in date with one another and then piggyback to then get to older map sequences. And there's much more success of georeferencing because they're reflecting a landscape that's closer in date rather than trying to constantly use modern day topography, which we know has changed quite a lot since the 20th century. So that's the tithe. The other thing I'll very quickly show you as well is down here, if you click that little button, you'll be able to get up the attribute information. So if I click on polled parcels for Nerquist, so every single field is represented in the attribute table here. But what this also enables to do is that we can set in filters. So again, the benefit of having vector data is it allows us to do a lot more than just being able to see a georeferenced image. So if I go add expression and let's go to landowner gender is, and then type in female. Bear with me, my keyboard will work. This is always the way, isn't it, that you want to do something. And there we go, female, click OK. And then what we'll see is if I zoom out, so all those fields now that have been selected are owned by a female. And in this case, the majority is owned by Miss Elizabeth Gifford of Nerquist Hall. So again, you know, it's not just owner gender we can use there. We can look for specific landowners or land type or land use. So there's a wealth of information we can capture by using that vector data as well. So I won't dwell, we'll go to the enclosure again just to show you here the examples we've got. So Mole Mountain is the one Scott was showing before, which is in areas, you know, you can see the original here, which is quite challenging to look at. But again, if we turn on the parcels, you've got it hopefully becomes a little bit clearer what's going on. And again, you've got all the information there of who was awarded what, the acreages, and again we can check that they're pretty close, so we're quite confident that's the geographical area. And again, you've got the more info there. So if I click on those hyperlinks, that'll take you through to any, you know, documents or websites we've linked to. So the tithe, that would take you through to the Places of Wales website and such and such. So again, just to prove that this is a portal by which we can link so much data and also external data as well, and sort of signpost to other institutions. But the key thing with this data set, though, is like Scott was saying, that pre-enclosure. And the reason this is important is that this gives us basically what we could argue as close to a medieval landscape as we can get. Because as you notice, all those roads and stuff that go through there didn't exist prior to 1800 or 1830. So it really strips out the landscape. And a lot of the ways that people see the landscape today in terms of, trackways and roadways, well, we can see that historically, you know, there might have been trackways across there, but there was no real significant infrastructure until post, you know, the turn of the 19th century. So again, it gives us this, a better understanding of landscape and its context, as well as how it's developed. But also, this is significantly important because when we go into the estate records, and we'll keep these on, it shows us why we've got massive gaps. Now, if we didn't understand where that upland area was, when we go to look at estate records, we'd see there would be massive gaps between the two areas. And that's because either no one owned those areas until the, you know, the enclosure came along. And what we'll also notice is that when you do start to click on some of these areas, so that's this, the 1620 map, for instance, you hopefully see how they butt up almost perfectly to that enclosure boundary edge. So this map is 1620, and what it tells us is that this boundary specifically is pretty much there in 1620 as well. So we were confident that, you know, a lot of these boundaries are a lot more older than we would credit for, really, and that probably this boundary between upland and lowland does go back at least to that sort of, you know, early 17th century at the earliest. But what is quite interesting about these maps, though, and as you can see, we've got a wealth of them ranging from 1858 right the way through to 1620. So we've got, you know, almost around 400 years of landscape there. But I'm just going to pick out one or two. So we've got this Nerquist Hall one, which is quite nice. And what's interesting with this map is that you've got the development of Nerquist Hall, which has changed significantly, water features. But from an archaeological point of view, what you do have here are the remnants of potential strip field systems. So if I turn on the, rather than the original map image, if I turn on the vector data, you can see you've got the survival of strip field systems. Now, when we look at that in conjunction with the tithe, you'll see that they don't actually carry on or they change. So again, if we turn on this for Nerquist, let me just clear that query from before, because that's going to hinder. So let me get rid of that. So you'll see that actually between the two, there's a few that still survive, but obviously on the left there, you've got one or two which have disappeared, and that one down the bottom there as well, that's gone. So again, you're starting to get these, you know, relics of landscape there, which is quite interesting. But if I also turn on the tithe as well for Trithin, what is quite good with these estate maps and looking at later sources is that we can actually start to click multiple features to see how that has changed. So again, if we turn on Nerquist, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick on, where was it? There's a field down here somewhere. Is this one? Yes. So you've got this field here, which is, bear with me. So you've got, this one, yeah, 1837 to 1848, it's Tir Mawr Issa. But if we, I don't know why this is, I need to zoom out a little bit, don't I? If I zoom out a little bit, so get the edge of, there we go. We see what it is in 1620. We can see the field name is still Tir Mawr Issa. So effectively, you've got, between those two dates, there's not much changing. But then if we look at 1620 again, you've got the same field name as well, Tir Mawr. So you can see that 1620, it was one big field. By 1720, so almost 100 years later, it's been split up between Issa and Ucha. And then that's continued until the 19th century, the tithe. So you've got a wealth of information here, not only about landscape change, but also from a place name point of view and field name point of view. And we can prove that that continuation of field name in some areas does go through, whereas in some areas it doesn't. But at least now what you've got here is that evidence base by which you've got that wealth of information that's accessible freely, you know, at the click of a button. The last couple of things I'll show you as well, as I'm conscious of time. We've also done the town plan, like Scott was saying before. So again, this is the same process. We've georeferenced the town plan to modern OS master map. And again, it's quite difficult. You can see the map here that, you know, with a black and white sheet, it's very difficult to work out what to build and what isn't. But we've done that hard work for you. So if I turn on that, parcels and buildings, as if by magic, hopefully you'll be able to work out what's going on there. So again, like Scott was saying, I can click on any one of these parcels and I've got all the information to do with that specific feature or building that was recorded on that map. Now, why this is also important is the date of this, 1871, if we can work out the footprint of these buildings and the numbers, potentially you can start to link other records to them. So what else was done in 1871? Well, it's the census. So if we can work out those footprints of buildings, potentially you can link those, that polygon, to the census record. And again, it gives you another way, rather than having a text-based search of the census, you can actually visualize it on a map, click on a street, and be able to work out who lived where. So say, for instance, you didn't know the number of your relative, but they knew they lived on Prince's Court. Well, theoretically, you could click on every one of those buildings until you come across the relative who may or may not live there. So again, it gives us a lot more options and a lot more availability to link vast amounts of data spatially in a way that's also easily accessible, hopefully to people like yourselves as researchers and you know, people interested in the historic environment. The very last thing I'll show you as well is that, again, the power of having all this information digitally is that we're increasingly moving away from 2D maps to 3D. So, for instance, if I turn this map on here, is the Grosvenor 1740 Estates, mountain survey. So, again, you'll be very familiar. Look at this. That's how you'd see it on a normal map. But then because we've got it in a program such as ArcScene, we can then actually change our view and be able to interrogate this landscape in 3D. Now, this gives us another element of the landscape that we wouldn't normally have with a paper map. And the fact that we can overlay these, you know, we're confident with the geographical accuracy in terms of its X and Y, but now we've also got depth in terms of a Z value. And again, you know, this also works like a GIS. So we can overlay the polygons here. So if I just go a little bit further down and put on the parcels for the Llanarmon Tide Survey, enclosure survey, sorry. Now, hopefully this should bring in the polygons. I might be a little bit too far north, actually. It's just loading. The only problem with this, though, is it does take quite a meaty computer to be able to generate all this information. So let's turn off there. There we go. Sorry, you've got this is the map underneath for the enclosure maps you were seeing before. And again, if I turn on the parcels for Llanarmon again, and again, with the GIS, I can click on any one of those parcels. You can see it in 3D, and all that information that you had in the normal web map is also there, the click of a button too. So hopefully, I hope that demonstrates the type of information we've got access to, the wealth of information we've got access to as well as the potential for this whole system. You know, this isn't just about being able to interrogate data. What this system demonstrates is that we can take a vast array of information, potentially from other sources, and bring it together into a consolidated and easy to access spatial reference as well. So I'm going to hand over back to my colleague Scott for our final slide, and then we'll hand over to questions. Thank you very much for listening. Scott, I don't know if you're still there.
Yeah, I'm still here. Don't worry, I'm still here. Okay, right. I'm just going to come back here. And we're going to, okay. There we go. So I'm just going to make a few conclusions of all of this. The method we've got of polygonized, of georeferencing, is very important. When you're doing massive amounts of sheets, people tend to use the four corners of the map sheet to georeference, which for most purposes is fine. However, if you want to do the detailed polygonization, you have to use the multi-point georeferencing, and this opens up lots of future potential. So rather than the four-point method, which in a way does dead-end you a little bit, doing the multi-point georeferencing, which takes a little bit longer, opens up a whole new potential of things you can do with the mapping. The polygonization of the first edition enables us to have a nice, clean set of polygons from 150 years ago, and all of the modern noise has been removed. The housing estates, the motorways, the bypasses, they've all been removed. So we've got something that's much closer in date to the earlier map sources which we're interested in. We do it this way once, takes a bit longer, but we can reuse it in a multiple different set of ways. And I think that's really important. People don't have to keep repeating the same work. We do it once, we make it available. The early maps are very concerned with cadastral data. By cadastral, I mean those books of references with field names, acreages, and land use. Those early maps have lots of place names, personal names, economic and sort of historic environment data in there as well. So it's important that that data is captured, but in a spatial manner. It helps us to improve the discoverability of all this material. For the small area that we've looked at, we've found over 200 maps. Not all of them have made it onto the system. We've tended to focus on the larger and the older maps, but some 200 maps of various sizes and scales going back over 400 years for six parishes. And I know we were told the other day that for Montgomeryshire, we were told there's 1,200 estate maps. How do you get all those into one system? How do you find them? How do you know where they are? By having this sort of spatial search, you can find them much easier than you can through a text-based catalogue. This also means that everything we're doing here is interoperable with modern systems. A lot of planning and government systems make use of Ordnance Survey Master Map as their basis. By having a system where the heritage data is in the same format and is linked to the master map in its spatial accuracy, it means all of this old data can be used in a modern way. And this is very important. It makes heritage and historic data relevant. And I think that's really important if we're going to keep it supported and get some funding to keep doing this type of work. As John's just showed you, you can now view the data in 3D, and you can also view it in virtual reality or augmented reality. And we should also mention as well that if you've got this website on your phone and you live in the project area, you can press the location button and you'll pop up as a little dot on your phone on top of a 400-year-old map. And as you walk across that landscape, your dot will move across the historic map. So when you're in the field, you can find that obscure boundary stone. Also, we're very keen that all that hard work done by local historians who have a wealth of knowledge and detail about an area that we can never hope to have, there's a format in which they can get it into this system, which is why earlier on I was saying please make use of Excel spreadsheets rather than Word documents for transcribing information. So if you've got a map and a book of reference, create a table of that information. And we're happy to help you with that as well. And then that information can then be incorporated across into the same system that you've seen today. So that means that the work of local historians can be seen in a national context. And I think that's really important. And also, perhaps the single most important thing, it should be easy to use. And we are trying to make refinements to the system to make it easier and easier to use and be freely accessible. I really don't like things being hidden behind paywalls. So there you go. Thank you for listening. I hope you found it interesting.
Well, Jock and Val, Scott and John, I'm scored the oral yawn. Thanks, Scott and John, for a very, very interesting talks. So I glory, hoffen ddioch yn fawr I chi am ymuno a ni hefyd, I staff y Comisiwn am Drefni, ac yn olaf, diolch yn fawr iawn I chi, John and Scott, am sgwrs diddorol iawn. Thank you all for joining us tonight, and thanks also to the Commission staff who've been involved with the arrangements, and of course to John and Scott for a fascinating talk. Nos da.